David, this is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And you know, most of the time when I say that, I've got absolutely nothing to back it up. Just, you know, it's just television fluff. But I think maybe this time it is.
It might be.
It might be.
I hope it will be.
We'll see.
This might be the show that'll help us go viral.
We'll find out.
Three votes right here.
Yeah. So let's do the little thing here. Is it going to come in? There we go. A little jittery. This is Ham Radio Now, episode, come on, you guys, episode 342. It ain't parody until we say it's parody.
That was good, Gary.
Yeah.
You might have a career in voiceover.
I have a great career behind me in voiceover.
That's a parody of whom?
You guys just wait a minute. You're not on the show yet. just wait a minute. Okay, so it tells me that I need to put up my title. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, the host of the show, and over there on the other side of the screen is...
I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG, the co-host of this show.
Okay, and now it is time for the fundraising. Where did I put the fundraising title? Oh, there it is. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the program, get something out of it, visit Arvin. There's my Arvin. There's Arvin. David's Arvin.
Arvin's over here.
And there he is. Look what I got in the mail just the other day.
An envelope full of pennies.
I got this letter. Gosh. I had said at some point you can go to the website and click on Arvin, and you can do Patreon, you can do PayPal, or you can just stuff a $10 bill in an envelope and send it along. And a couple of days later, this arrived, and there's more than a $10 bill. There's a 20 and a 10, and it's fairly anonymous. And it was somebody who was telling me that I can see myself from last field day if I go to the W4OT field day YouTube page. And they show them talking to me. And I actually got that some time ago and put it online. So
yes. You're going to un-anonymize him? You're going to do it right here?
No,
right
now? I can't, because he didn't tell me who he was.
But you said you had video of him. He had video of
you. No. The video is from W4OT, a Florida field day operation.
Yeah.
So talking to me, KN4AQ, in my mobile as I was driving from one place to another. Are you doing a BBC thing on me?
Yeah, I am. I had one of my little hams just ran in with the papers that I left on the couch that I was reading.
Okay. So, all right, let's go on with the show. David, I was at my local radio club meeting last week, and the club vice president who was running the meeting, president was out. He read the ARRL pitch that most of you have received that is trying to exhort you to support the Amateur Radio Parity Act to call your senators. And I think everybody was already fairly familiar with that. You got it. You put it on the Facebook page.
I did. And now I'm afraid I'm not sure I did the right thing or not.
You're wondering about that.
I am.
At that club meeting, a couple of members started to kind of fidget while he was reading that. And he said, "You know, do you guys want to say anything?" Well, they wanted to, but they didn't. You know, they're kind of on the edge of protesting it, but they didn't. They seemed kind of uncomfortable in the meeting, stirring up a debate. Maybe they didn't have all their ducks in a row for what they were going to argue about the Parity Act. So this is it. We are here. We are here to help. And let me push a couple of buttons here. Things are in the wrong place, but I can get this done. So, in the upper left-hand corner, ladies and gentlemen, for his second return appearance on Ham Radio Now, is Fred Hopengarten, K1VR, AntennaZoning.com, published author. Got to stick my head up above this. and in general, Ham Radio curmudgeon, I think. Fred, welcome back to the program.
Good to have you. I'd rather be known as a contester.
Oh, okay. official contester. And in the upper right-hand corner, weighing in it, I've got absolutely no idea how much, is Jim Talons, N3JT, a former FCC attorney. There are stories.
Nobody, Nobody's perfect, right?
There are stories, aren't there?
Yeah.
I see, David, I see a future program when we ask him to tell stories.
Mm. Yep.
You were not in the amateur radio end of things.
No.
Right. So, and really don't know that much about what the ham things did.
Ham?
The ham wing of the FCC.
Ham? Okay.
Yeah. I got the joke.
Yeah.
Thank you.
What are they? Well, back when Bill Cross was there at W3TN, people knew, at least he knew what it was. Was he there all alone? Did he look, you know, around what was his office area and go, "Hello, is there anyone out here?"
The office wasn't that big.
Okay. Not that much.
But he was alone.
So it was him. Okay. Right. So, I say there's stories. I'm looking forward to it. And also contributing to the documentation that produced this program is a friend of yours, David, Marty Wall, N6VI.
Yeah, our former vice director of Southwest area region. Yeah.
But we didn't have enough Skype to bring him on the show, or he just supplied us with a lot of information.
Yeah, he gave us a ton of content.
Okay, so we're going to take a look at stuff in a minute. But first, Fred, let me boost you up to full screen here for a moment. And that's a mistake because you're hanging off to the side of the frame.
I can move if you want.
You put yourself in the middle for at least a moment.
Or at least I could move completely out of it.
Well, I'm going to make it irrelevant because I'm going to punch up some web stuff. The last time you were on, we were talking about a tower case that you were involved in that hadn't quite been completed. It was getting close. It was Gary Wadke, WW8N, and he lived in Ohio. And you are acting as his attorney, fighting not a Parity Act case, because there wasn't any Parity Act, and really there still isn't yet. It was PRB1, and here's the good news. See if I can make this work. The court confirms all prior orders in this case, including this is way back in 2014, final judgment, holding that, among other things, the plaintiff, that is Gary, WW8N, is entitled to erect a tower to construct a 60-foot Rhone 55G tower for amateur radio antennas and all of its constituent parts for the amateur radio antenna system, including but not limited to the mast, the antenna, the rotor, the cabling, guy wires, the antenna support, and the structure, all of which together exceeds the height of the 55G tower. So he's going to go a little above 60 feet. This consent order is the equivalent of a building permit because the town was just not going to issue a building permit, were they?
It was so strange. Even after they lost the court case, they wouldn't issue a building permit. So we had to get an order from the judge, which you just read.
Yeah. So here it is. This consent order is the equivalent of a building permit issued by the defendant, the city, under Ohio law, and gives the plaintiff, his heirs, successors, and assigns, that sounds pretty much like legal, all the rights of a duly assigned building permit, et cetera, et cetera. And down there at the bottom, the defendant is to reimburse, the defendant being the town, is to reimburse the plaintiff for his attorney's fees reasonably incurred in bringing this motion. And now I'm going to put your face back on camera because I want to see what you do when I read this next line. Not to exceed $500.
Now, was that just for getting the building permit or was that for the whole case? Because if I could see if it was just about getting the building permit, you know, maybe not a huge deal.
The whole case.
The whole case. Yeah. Oh, sorry, Fred.
So he got, well, I'm assuming that Gary had to kick in a little bit.
He contributed
on this, and I'm not going to embarrass you by asking how much. But I
got an envelope, which I unfolded and found dollar bills in.
Yeah,
just like you.
The last time we talked, you had something that you could tell people was sort of a getting started. I forget what that was, but if you got a tower case you want to litigate, be ready to start someplace and go up from there. What was that? Do you remember what you told me, or do you have a starting figure in mind?
I charge $1,500 to open a file.
Okay. So that's the retainer to start the process?
The word retainer is a tricky issue.
Okay.
When you pay, retainer implies that you burn that off and it's not, it's still your money until I earn it.
Uh-huh.
$1,500 is mine the moment I open the envelope.
It's the opening okay. gambit.
Got it.
That's what it costs you for me to review and open your case.
And then it goes from there.
I do burn it off,
yeah.
but you'll never see that $1,500 again.
Got it.
Okay. Well, no matter how, what you do next, you look at
right.
you look at the initial documents. That's $1,500, and then you work up from there. All right. So that's good news for Gary and good news for PRB1.
I will say that as an ARRL volunteer counsel, the first hour, which is when I do the review, the initial review, is free.
Okay.
You only pay the $1,500 if you want to go forward.
How many of those do you do in an average year, if there is such a thing?
Hmm. 6 to 10?
That's quite a bit. And is ham radio antenna litigation your primary business?
Exclusive? I hope not to litigate, but ham radio antenna matters.
Okay.
Is pretty much what I do, unless it's some other kind of communications matter. I'm a member of the Federal Communications Bar Association, and I do things like that.
So you might argue for a cell phone tower or radio station.
On my website, you'll see that it's divided into commercial work and ham radio work.
Okay, and I had your website up here. I don't see it anymore. But it is antennazoning.com.
Very simple. I have a clear and simple brand.
Yep. Okay. So I forgot to look at Facebook and see if we're really here. So let me.
We're there. We got about 10 people in the room, and I'm monitoring.
Okay. So, if you've got a comment or a question as we go along, type it into the Facebook Live chat, and David will pick it up and toss it into the program. And I'm going to make that go away and save my bandwidth. So I guess we'll get started, and let me put myself here on camera, and I'm going to do a little bit of background, and let me get through this whole background, and then you guys can correct me when I screw it up. 1985, the FCC created PRB1. PRB1 was our relief from government overreach and regulations. It applied only to governments, to states, counties, cities and towers. There were three pillars of that FCC rule. It said that any town's ordinances, any state, any county, must not preclude the amateur radio service. Got to be able to get on ham radio. They must reasonably accommodate such communications, and they must constitute the minimum practicable regulation. They did not cover HOAs. They don't cover deeds. They don't cover CCNAs. CCNRs. Codes, covenants, and restrictions. All right. So PRB1 from 1985. The ARRL had pretty much continuously attempted to get the FCC to extend PRB1 coverage to HOAs. The FCC said no. Ask Congress. This happened over a period of time. In 2011, Congress directed the FCC at the request of the ARRL. I mean, the ARRL went to Congress and said, we want to cover CCNRs. We want to cover HOAs. Congress didn't authorize that, but instead they directed the FCC to study the effects of restrictions on amateur radio. And around 2011, the FCC came back with the results of their study, you know, like the dragnet. In a moment, the results of that trial. Their conclusion, no problem. We're okay. We're doing fine. ARRL, if you want to pursue this, go ask Congress again. So they did. In 2015, HR 1301, numbers that will live in infamy, was introduced in the House. It got stalled in a committee chaired by a ham, Greg Walden, W7EQI. It got stalled there until the FCC reached a compromise in the language of H.R. 1301 with a group called the CAI, the Community Associations Institute. It's the national organization of HOAs. I don't know if they've got every HOA in it. Probably not, but they got a lot. That compromise language came out, and it was passed by the full House in 2016. The same language was introduced in the Senate, where it went nowhere because it got put on hold by one senator, Senator Bill Nelson of Florida. I think he's a Democrat. He objected to the way the bill overrode a private contract. Even with the compromise language? Well, it's not really clear, but apparently, even with the compromise language, that bill died at the end of the prior congressional session at the end of 2016. And in the course of that, some hams objected to the original bill, boiled the objection down just a little bit too much to, you signed the contract, deal with it. 2017, beginning of this year, it was reintroduced with the compromise language. It became H.R. 555, also Senate Bill 1534. It was very quickly passed by the House in a voice vote, one of those things where they shove a lot of non-controversial legislation through. It is sitting at the Senate. Senate has not acted yet. So I was talking about the hams that were objecting to the original language, saying you signed a contract. It's a private contract. The government shouldn't go in there and abrogate the private contract. You like that, Fred? Jim? Yeah. Abrogate? Pulled that out of thin air. The ham said that the federal government should not override the contract because you signed it. You knew what you were getting into. Well, there's plenty of arguments about that. Not every ham knew what they were getting into. Some folks weren't hams. We have children. So there's lots of reasons why we can ask for relief. And in my way of thinking, asking for some kind of override like that is dealing with it, not just sitting back and taking it, but that's a way to deal with it. Well, there has been some more substantial opposition to this compromise language, and that's where you guys come in. I'm not sure when you got started with this, but you've all published something. Let me take a look at it here briefly. This is on CQ, so Jim Talons, this is your article.
It is, but actually Fred is the genesis of this at Dayton.
Fred's the instigator?
He is.
Okay. That began with a talk that you gave at Dayton then. A talk which, by the way, you told me that wouldn't be something I could record and put on ham radio now. But I'm not complaining. I understand. And you had other people there with you, so. But you're here now, so we're good. So you gave that talk. Have you published it anyplace? Is it online anywhere for people to get?
The PowerPoint is online somewhere.
Someplace.
Can't remember.
Because I did a quick search and I didn't find that. But
the paper, which is easier to understand than bullet points, which are lacking all of the finer details, is widely available. N6TV put it up with a tiny URL, spread that out to the Northern California Contest Club, and it's been published in other places.
Okay. The title of that was Just Say No to H.R. 555 S1534. Just Say No. And I'll stick that on the Ham Radio Now website when we're done with this. Okay, so Jim, you're here at CQ Magazine, and this is on their website currently. They begin with their own white paper, which describes what they're talking about. And then they point to the first article that you did for them.
By the way, I should note before you go on that this message, what you're going over now, was sent to 29,000 subscribers and recipients. So a lot of people got that.
Of the magazine?
Of the summary, the white paper.
Okay. Yeah, for CQ subscribers, right. In addition to being here on their website. So
it's not been published yet in paper, of course.
Yeah, I think it's in the digital version, I think. Right. It's in the August issue anyway. So
that's so when you said correct. When you said you sent that to 27,000 subscribers, that was like separate paper mail or via email or
no, that CQ sent the email out with that white paper to subscribers.
Got it.
Yeah, so that would be this white paper. They were just probably linked to the article that we're looking at now.
So, in addition, it's linked to my article.
Okay. So then there's this, this is what you began with, why HR 555 is not good enough for hams, which is, you know, interesting. The ARRL caught wind of it and they, wrote up it is a rebuttal. They called it a FAQ, frequently asked questions, and it's right up at the top of their Parity Act webpage. And so if you look at it, it's a PDF, the Amateur Radio Parity Act, Setting the Record Straight. And they go through point by point many of the points that you guys made. And then you wrote up a response to that. So, you know, it's kind of been going back and forth. So the purpose of this show, because all that stuff is out there, people can go read it, is that conversations can be more interesting. And we'll reach some people that are not going to spend a long time reading, and we'll get to hear it in your own voice. So that's why we do TV shows. That's pretty much why CNN, MSNBC, and Fox News exist. So here we are on television. Yay. Yay for us. How's my introduction? Did I cover the basics, the history? Did I get anything too far screwed up?
If you'd like to know what I found wrong with your introduction,
sure.
It is that you that the correct meaning of CC and Rs is common covenants and restraints. They're normally restraints of record.
Wow, nobody knows that except for you,
Fred. Well,
and real estate lawyers. So if that's my big mistake, I'm going to go with that. I'll take it. Common covenants and restraints. This almost sounds like an adult video. All right. So, guys, as you know, I attempted to make an outline to guide the discussion here. This is not an attempt at being a common covenant nor a restraint. This is to, you know, just for me to try to keep things together, but I expect it to fall apart. But the first thing I want to ask is, we've been calling this the Amateur Radio Parity Act for a long time. What is the parity that we're trying to find? Are we trying to find parity with what they call OTARD, the over-the-air receiving device rules that the FCC came out with that lets people put up TV antennas basically and satellite dishes, no matter, you know, what their, not no matter what their HOA or their condo association says, that they can still have some rules about it, but they are allowed to do it. Is that what we're parity with? Are we trying for parity with PRB1, or are we trying for parity with HOAs to level the playing field so that we've all got a seat at the table and we're all dealing with things from an equal point of, power? Where would you guys go?
The short answer to that is that in the act as introduced, it says this act may be cited as the Amateur Radio Parity Act of 2017, but nowhere else in the document does it use the word parity. So we don't know.
Okay.
The answer to the question that you've asked, whether it's to put things on parity with PRB1 or with the OTARD, over-the-air reception devices rule, we just don't know.
So it's just really badly named, basically.
No, cleverly.
Or not well-defined. Cleverly named.
Okay. I think Jim has it right. Cleverly named.
Cleverly named, okay.
Because it sounds good. It's PR. It's a PR move. All right.
I think ARRL, though, had to the back of their minds mainly PRB1, since that was their experience.
Yeah, and as we'll discover as we go through this, we're not getting there. Okay, so I kind of, by going through all the documents that you guys prepared, I kind of pulled out seven main points of contention to talk about. And you, I gave you the list and you came back and said one of them should be higher in the list, should be up at the top of the list. So I did move things around a little bit. And I think the thing I've got here is what we're looking at. I would call it the installation requirements, where the Parity Act 555 says a community association may establish reasonable written rules concerning the height, location, size, and aesthetic impact of and installation requirements for outside antennas and support structures. And let's pick out one word from that to begin with, and that it will be the word aesthetics. And Fred, I believe you've
before you get to that,
yeah. I would use
notice that it says may.
Yeah. The
community may establish. They're not required to establish.
Exactly.
Okay. So how does that affect things if they don't? If they don't establish rules.
Then what are they bound to?
Well, I mean, let's put it into a practical situation. Guy is living in a neighborhood, wants to put up his antennas, approaches his HOA, say this is what has been passed. They probably don't know anything about it, so he hands them a sheaf of papers that says this is the Amateur Radio Parity Act. Look it over, and let's say they don't have any regulations. Well, what happens next?
The association can choose to do something or choose to do nothing. But whichever route the association takes, the radio ham has to get a prior approval. So he could be stuck.
Because they're not giving a prior, they're not giving approval.
Because there's no rule under which they can issue it.
It seemed to me that they could do whatever they want, you know, whether they've got a rule or not. But then I'm not a lawyer. But.
Well, what about the situation where the community association, this act talks about community associations, not homeowner associations. The community association in this particular circumstance we're discussing is a road association. It meets the definition of the act, but the road, the plowing, the trash, maybe the maintenance of a common beach is the only purpose of the community association. So they don't have power to issue the approval. So you're asking somebody who doesn't have the power to issue you a prior approval.
I get that.
You're stuck.
I get that. The rule also says that that the association is prohibited from failing to permit a licensee, the amateur radio service, to install and maintain an effective outdoor antenna. It says they must permit him to install and maintain an effective outdoor antenna. Now we'll get to the language of the effective outdoor antenna a little bit later on, but so the rule is telling them they have to, but their own rules don't give them a structure for doing that. I mean, what would you do in that situation if you were the attorney for the ham?
I'd likely tell the ham, if it's a community association with no rules and apparently no power, I'd tell the ham to put up his antenna.
Okay. So,
but we get back to something else. The requirement is a prior approval. So the ham's got his antenna up in the air, but he doesn't have his prior approval. Okay. Now, moments ago, we were talking about the actual meaning of CC&R, which is a common covenant and restraint. The word common becomes important because under a common covenant, every homeowner has made a promise to obey the rules. It's a common promise. And as a consequence, any homeowner can enforce the rules. So even though the association may take no action when you put up your antenna, I can envision a situation where any officious neighbor, not even a neighbor, some guy who lives a mile away, or in some of these places where you're talking about 50-acre lots, 10 miles away, can seek to get at you in some way or another because you don't have a prior approval.
Yeah, they can complain and say you don't have prior approval.
So you just bought yourself a lawsuit.
But who are they going to complain to? So you basically, you'd have to take it to court at that point, because there's no homeowner association that might actually do anything.
The rogue neighbor files a suit.
Right.
Complains that you don't have a prior approval.
Okay.
And then the court has to make a decision. You're a defendant.
Yeah, and I can see where we want to stay out of court as much as possible. And, you know, I think we've got some points later on where we talk about what PRB1 does and what OTAR does in terms of relief. So let's get to that down the road a little bit. Let's talk about aesthetics, because I think you called it, Fred, you called it the antenna killer.
Yes. So, actually, I think Jim likes this topic better than I do.
But, I do.
Go ahead, Jim.
Well, I mean, this aesthetics are in the mind of the HOA, and clearly they would be the arbiters of what decision would be made, and therein lies the problem.
Because they're ambiguous.
Well, there is no definition of what's what's aesthetically acceptable. Probably in the rules, there's none. Everybody knows of HOAs where everybody has to have the same color front door and that sort of thing. Those are in the rules, but I don't think the aesthetics in terms of an antenna are described anywhere. I can't imagine. Maybe in terms of height replacement, if indeed there are rules at all, which usually there are not, there would be nothing. So they would have a blank slate to establish those rules.
So, Fred, you've been through aesthetics arguments in dealing with just plain PRB1, which also allows rules of municipalities based on aesthetics. Where have you gone with that? How have you arrived at definitions?
The difference is that in an argument about PRB1, the community, not the community association, but the municipality or the county is required to accommodate the radio amateur. Here, I'm not sure that accommodation with respect to the communications that the radio amateur desires is required under this statute.
Okay.
Now, on the question of aesthetics, a city or town can take into account the aesthetics, but while still being required to accommodate the communications that the radio amateur desires, that limits their ability. They can't just say it's inconsistent with our policy of red brick, white trim, green doors. They have to say that the community association, excuse me, the municipality has to say, well, we can require some vegetative screening. We can require that it be placed in the backyard so long as communications can still be accomplished. But they still have to, one way or another, they're going to have to accommodate the communications that the radio ham desires. That's not really true here. The bill says community associations should fairly administer private land use restrictions in the interest of their communities, while nevertheless permitting the installation and maintenance of effective outdoor amateur radio antennas. And it says there exist antenna designs and installations that can be consistent. Yeah, you know, I don't know where this goes. I just don't know where it goes. I think it's a big setup for a big fight.
Okay.
And I can see a community association arguing that your 43-foot vertical in the backyard is not consistent with the standards of their community and is therefore forbidden, even in a situation where the antenna is entirely behind the house in the backyard and cannot be seen from a public way.
Yeah, I can't get away from the idea that a lot of the time what we're talking about in terms of reaching a conclusion for all of this, assuming this is what became law, is tell it to the judge and try to convince him to see it your way, which is expensive, but it's always been expensive.
And Gary, the difference is the question of who has the burden of convincing the judge.
Yep.
And I always prefer it when the municipality has the burden of defending, as opposed to the amateur having the burden of showing that it is consistent with aesthetics that are undefined.
This still has that minimum practicable language in it, doesn't it?
As an alternative.
Yeah. Oh, that was that what your and or.
That's the or clause.
Right.
Yeah, I'm not sure how fast I can find that.
At 3A3.
Section 3.
Let's see.
Well, yeah, you're looking for that.
You just went by it. It's before the words additional requirements.
You were right there.
Okay.
Right there.
You see, move your hand.
Line 9, right? Line 8.
Yeah. You see the or
On
line 8?
Yeah.
See the or on line 8?
At the end of line 8. It's that or.
So let me read this for the folks that aren't able to watch it.
Control of the licensee or.
Yeah. So the homeowners association or the, what do you want me to call it? The
community association.
Community association is not allowed to make regulations that preclude communications in the amateur radio service that fail to permit a licensee in the amateur service to install or maintain an effective outdoor antenna on property under the exclusive use or the control of that licensee. And that's another issue. Or does not constitute the minimum practicable restriction on such communications to accomplish the lawful purposes of the community association. So let me unpack that or parse it one more time. You can't tell them that they can't put in an antenna, an effective outdoor antenna on their property, or you can't set up rules that don't constitute a minimum practicable restriction. I'm not sure I can wrap my brain around what the difference is, what that does.
Let's try to get out of the double negatives.
Yeah.
Please.
So a community association, because of the word or, has a choice. They are required to allow, I'm trying to avoid the negatives. They're required to allow communications in the amateur service, and they're required to permit an installation of an outdoor antenna. Or they can have rules that constitute the minimum practicable restriction.
So I guess I don't see why they're that different.
So help me understand, what would the rules for the minimal practicable restriction, what would that, or what could that, should that look like?
Yeah, why would that be different?
Requirement number 3, which is a minimum practicable restriction, that means they have to have a piece of paper. 1 and 2 means they have to allow, they can't preclude communications, and they have to allow an outdoor antenna. So under 1 and 2, they can allow you a 440 megahertz WIP. sticking out your window, and you'll be able to talk to our local repeater or to a car in the parking lot. And if they do that, they are not required to establish minimum practicable restrictions.
So does a ham have an argument against the idea that a 70 centimeter whip is adequate? I mean, it would take an astute homeowners association to understand that's what they want to do.
Yeah, but it's not going to be just,
I don't think so at all.
It's not, no, not at all.
Because this will spread, you know, suddenly the word will get out.
What do you think the trade association, CAI, does for a living?
Yeah, so they'll spread the word.
They'll know.
So is there an argument against it? I mean, there's argument against it. How effective might it be?
You're going to wind up being forced to go to court to argue to a judge on equitable principles that the 440 whip may be effective and it may be outdoors, but it's not what was intended.
And it's not minimum practicable, but that language is now out.
Well, that's not required language.
Yeah.
Because
they met A, and so because they met A,
they don't have to meet B.
Okay, I got it.
That's the meaning of the word or.
Yeah. And I realize that there's a fatal flaw in my organizational structure here. As we're going through this, I sort of want to say, well, what would the alternative language be? But I've kind of stuffed that together into a discussion, hopefully at the end of the program, just to keep you guys watching all the way to the end, where we'll talk about what the alternatives could be, but there isn't anything written up already that's an alternative.
Well,
a simple solution is to change it to the word and.
Exactly.
In that case, change that word to and.
And that brings it closer to PRB1 in effect, too.
Yeah. Do you think that that or was somebody being lazy or sloppy or cagey and slipped something by?
I don't think it was slipping by. I think it was the power of negotiation of CAI in a room with ARRL.
So that was a 30-minute negotiation on,
I don't know,
those
wasn't there
three or four letters.
I don't think it was accidental, that's for sure.
We don't know, and I agree. I don't think it was accidental by the CAI. I don't think that that the word "and" from PRB1 was changed to "or"
exactly
by CAI.
Yeah. Okay. So in PRB1, it was "and." They had to do both.
Correct.
So David, these guys are getting it. The if you watch CNN, Fox, MSNBC, the pundits get to talk about what they think, and of course the government, in many cases, or corporations, they don't tell us what they really did. And in this case, the ARRL is not, I've tried to get them on. I've tried to get them to talk to me about what the negotiation was all about, how it went down, and crickets. They won't even respond.
Gary, this might be a good point for you just to spend a second and outline what the current thinking is at ARRL and their new loyalty oath, all that sort of stuff.
I think that's a whole show. But
you can summarize it.
Yeah, you guys pointed me toward that, and they came out in the January board meeting. And I looked it over quickly, and I would need to spend a little more time before I could do a good job summarizing it. But it basically says that league officers, directors can't just talk about their own impressions and interpretations about what the league is doing. They have to toe the party line outside of the board meeting. They can argue all they want inside the board
meeting. And they can't reveal how they voted.
Yeah, if it isn't in the minutes, and sometimes it is, and sometimes it's not, I guess.
Okay, so but is it that they can't reveal how they voted, or do they have to toe the party line? Because for me, the first okay, but the second's a problem because I'm voting for these people as a member of the ARRL, and if I vote for these people as a member of the ARRL to represent me, and they have to toe the party line, who cares who I put in the seat, right?
I think that's a point. Yes. That's one we're going to dig into later on.
That's that other show.
Yeah. I got a little bit of that back in Orlando.
It deserves a show, and the directors and vice directors cannot speak against an ARRL action. That would be defying their duty of loyalty.
Even if they don't like something, they voted against it, and that vote has not been recorded in the minutes or has not been made public by the league, they can't tell you how they voted, and they can't tell you what their argument against it was. And that sounds anti-democratic.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah, that's kind of lame. And that should be another show.
Yeah, I think that I would love to take credit saying that they did that because of shows like mine, but I think it was mostly because of that director in Florida that raised a ruckus and they found a way to keep him from running for office again. So we did one show about that, and then they were trying to do a recall, and that lost, and don't know where that's going. You guys know who I'm talking about, and I don't even remember his name. Doug, was it?
Hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
So back to and or.
Yeah.
Back to and or. So my non-lawyerly mind, I wonder if you guys think, was that the ARRL got outplayed or had to fold, or was, I mean, I'm not, you know, why did it change? What do you guys think?
If I may, it may be all of those things or none of them. It's hard to tell. None of us was in that room at the time.
Yeah.
But certainly one of the people who was there is pretty defensive about his activities and his efforts. But, you know, any of us put in the room under those circumstances without huge, huge amounts of experience in dealing with large lobby organizations in a legislative environment might feel overpowered as well. And if you were given a take it or leave it, under those circumstances, when your employer says come back with something, you may have had no choice. So it could be any of what you suggested.
Okay.
Would you agree, Fred?
I agree, but I want to emphasize that as best we know, these are men of good morals and high ethics, and they just didn't wind up at the end with a product that I can recommend.
Yeah, it wasn't corrupt. They didn't get paid off to sell us out, because there are hams out there saying we got sold out. I don't think that they literally mean we got sold out, like money changed hands, but I think the intimation
compromise
is
compromise beyond.
Yeah, that they just didn't do a good job.
It's entirely possible that any of us in that same circumstance would have left that room with the same agreement or no agreement.
I'm absolutely sure I would have messed it up.
All right. Let's move on, because we are at, you know, 50-minute point and have covered one of seven. Prior approval. If there's no way, we talked about this a little bit, if there's no HOA to approve it, if they don't have any rules ready, if they stall and never respond, the ARRL says an indefinite stall would violate the entitlement to an effective outdoor antenna, and the amateur could enforce the entitlement in court. Okay, so we're back in court. Fred's making money.
Can I add something, just a little point on that, whether it's Fred or somebody else? What does a ham have to think of when he's really angry and wants to sue? He has to come back to earth and realize how much it's going to cost. $10,000, a lot more maybe. But more than that, it's the time. Fred, how long does one of these take, would you estimate it would take one of these cases to go from initial complaint to final appeal resolution?
How long did Gary Wadke take?
4 years.
Yeah,
so actually, a little more, because I didn't get into it soon enough, but... if you want a number, I'll say 2 to 4 years.
Wow. Okay. My wife is not the FCC,
going for that. If it's the FCC on a complaint, if it could be raised in their jurisdiction, I mean, I filed a rulemaking petition not long ago, and it's been a year and a half, and it hasn't even been put out as an NPRM yet. So it could even be longer there.
So things plod, although this stuff is in court, not in the FCC.
In court, every matter that's criminal comes before.
Okay. Because this is just a civil action.
Right. We don't have a Speedy Trial Act.
No, and the FCC might be the place where you would go first, or have to, because of the way the rules might be written. But there's no enforcement, as we've talked about, or we haven't talked about yet. There's no enforcement provision.
And there's no remedy provision.
Yeah. Okay. Correct. So that's down the road a little bit. So the idea that going to court is not a satisfactory alternative is the only answer to these things. There is some, I suppose, due diligence to discussing the idea of, are these complaints, you know, maybe there's no HOA, maybe they don't have any rules, maybe they stall. Are they left field arguments? Are they, you know, not likely to happen? You know, they'll happen in a few cases, but most of the time that's not what's going to happen. I guess the other way to look at this is, are we sacrificing something good for something that's not perfect?
No. And the reason is, I can understand a stronger argument for this as a starting point if the prior approval language was not the keystone of it. Because under this bill, we have radio hams who do not now have prior approval. They have hidden antennas. They have antennas that cannot be found by the neighbors. And life is good.
And they could have gone to their HOA.
They could have.
Which has rules.
Go ahead, David. What if there's that absentee HOA? I mean, I guess that's where I'm... if there's the absentee HOA and you make your request, who do you even make your request to?
Yeah, see, I kind of look at the absentee HOA as, you know, if it's not a red herring, you know, it's a pink herring.
Yeah, okay.
Well, the situation there, though, is where once you may have been violating a common covenant and restraint, a purely contractual matter, mm-hmm. you're now violating a federal law.
Got it.
Which somebody could make a big deal out of.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
So my In the original issue, if there's a CCNR and I put up my antenna, there's nobody to complain to about it, but my neighbor complains about it, he can take me to court, right? For against the non-cooperation with the CCNR. Now it's Correct. A federal thing. Now yeah. it's a federal thing, and I guess he can take me to federal court against this 555 saying I didn't have prior approval.
Isn't your immediate remedy as soon as this goes through, go to your HOA and say, I would like approval for this antenna? You'll spend a few minutes as a felon, but pretty soon you get the approval that they are required to give you, or they got to come up with a good reason why the antenna that no one has ever seen doesn't meet their requirements.
But what if they say no? What if they say no? Oh, go ahead, Fred.
Where does it say that they have to come up with a good reason?
Ooh, that's a good point.
Well, it is. Okay. I think it does. Not in so many words, but it says they have to permit an effective antenna or minimum practical regulations. Somewhere in there, I think we can squeeze out the idea that they have to be reasonable.
Not so sure I would agree with that entirely.
And that's based on that May clause, yeah. right?
I guess what we're looking at is then there will certainly be edge cases where that gets pulled out and causes a problem.
None of you in this is in Florida. Well, maybe there are listeners who are.
Yeah. Yeah, there are.
But I can certainly, they would tell you immediately that the HOAs there in very many cases are run by people who, through perhaps the aging process, I'm not sure if that's the only answer, but it would appear to be that way, get highly emotional and highly protective of their jurisdictions over the community and the enforcement of those rules,
yeah.
including particularly the aesthetics. They would not take...
Woe unto you if you leave your garage door open.
We've got a rule about that. By the way,
that is absolutely correct. Fred is right. It gets to that point. There are people who drive around looking for antennas. I know they are. I've seen it. So if you have an antenna up and you've gotten away with it, and the administration, I call it, will finds out about it, woe upon you. They will not be happy about it. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised, as I wrote somewhere or other, that it occurred to me that if I were running one of those organizations and had that mindset, I might very well issue, suspecting there may be some hams with clandestine antennas, a letter to the entire community saying you are now in violation of federal law by having those antennas. And if you do have one of those antennas, what will you do? Will you leave it up? I would not.
But isn't there the burden for them to come and find it, though? I mean, how do they know to come after you if they can't find it?
They suspect there may be word of mouth. It's somewhere in a community of 1,500 homes. They know there's a ham. Maybe word of mouth has gotten around. They don't know who. But they issue a letter of warning. And what would you as the ham do then? This converts from a simple violation of a contract where somebody comes by and says, you better take out that antenna. Take out that antenna or you will pay a $50 fine. Or would you prefer... now in a federal case.
Yeah.
Gary's point is that they would. So Gary, as the ham, you should go and ask for approval. But I think what you're saying is now they don't have to really even do anything about it.
Well, this is the case where you've got an antenna clandestinely operating.
They can hassle you because the antenna is there. So maybe you got to take it down, then go ask for permission to put it back up.
You could.
If you're in a contentious environment like that, yeah, I can see that happening. I still think that those are more. Maybe not totally edge cases, and you can have plenty of them, but I'm still always going to be looking for balancing what this could do positively for hams versus where you could have trouble.
That notion is not unreasonable either, because there will be cases where any federal legislation could encourage some HOAs to be more receptive.
Yeah.
In my own HOA in Florida, we have, I've talked at great length to some of the board members, convinced them of the benefits of having a ham radio operation on their property, well, our property, and they ultimately changed the rules to allow it. Yeah. So it's not impossible. My neighboring communities would never hear of such a thing. I know that.
But some hams start looking for a fight, and they don't even try to not be looking for a fight.
You're absolutely correct. Yeah. The approach is critical, particularly in these communities.
Okay, so moving on, if we could. We've already talked about limiting what bands you can operate by limiting the antenna size, but I'll revisit it just for a moment, because the 555 doesn't specify that you can operate on all bands. So maybe a 2-meter whip would qualify as an effective outdoor antenna and permit the licensee in an amateur radio service to install and maintain an effective outdoor antenna.
That meets the letter of the law.
Yeah, the argument could be made. ARRL responds that all bands, being able to operate all bands covered by this, is beyond the scope of both the Parity Act and PRB1. And PRB1 also doesn't address all bands. So that's not really an answer other than to tell hams, sorry, you're not going to get it all. To push the argument, maybe to an extreme, 160-meter, double ZEP is probably not something most people are going to be able to put up.
But Gary, as Fred pointed out earlier, there's the reasonable accommodation. That opens the window and puts the burden on the governing authority to say, why not? That's a very different world than this.
If we got that so
let me
and
read, let
back.
Me read to you, let me read to you from the original PRB1.
Yeah.
This is the FCC talking. Some amateur antenna configurations require more substantial installations than others if they are to provide the amateur operator with the communications that he, she, desires to engage in. For example, an antenna array for international amateur communications will differ from an antenna used to contact other amateur operators at shorter distances. Local regulations, which involve placement screening or height of antennas based on health, safety, or aesthetic considerations, must be crafted to accommodate reasonably amateur communications and to represent the minimum practicable regulation.
Was that what you would call discussion in that language, or was that actually part of the rule?
If I recall correctly, it's the last paragraph of the rule, and the phrase here is local regulations must be crafted to accommodate. That's not helpful. It's not a footnote. It's an order. And the reason I know it's an order is when the original PRB1 was converted into the regulation that got published, it in the way it was published in the Code of Federal Regulations, it says, let's see.
Yeah, I've got it up on
9715B. Oh, yeah, you have a 15B?
Got it online now, yeah.
Okay. 97.15B. A station antenna structure must be erected, may be erected at heights and dimensions sufficient to accommodate amateur service communications. Now, the league is correct when they say that that does not, in its sentence, say all bands, but it does say that you're entitled to heights and dimensions sufficient. And now you get back into the reasonableness issues.
Yeah.
But because of the or clause, as Jim points out, this is, reasonableness is not required.
Yeah, and here's the and that we're talking about. It's they must reasonably accommodate such communications and must constitute the minimum practicable regulation to accomplish the state or local authority's legitimate purpose. So the rest of those details must be in this FCC 101 second 952.
That is the PRB 1 ruling from 1985. That's just the citation for it.
Okay. All right. So not black and white exactly, but
never was.
Arguments can be made on both sides. So here's my note about that, what I'm going to call the roads-only HOAs. Apparently there are some HOAs out there that have very limited functions, like plowing a road. My HOA doesn't plow the road, not in North Carolina.
Does it maintain a common beach or a picnic area?
It maintains a sign and some foliage. And
what's to maintain? You don't get snow there.
Well, we do now and then. And no one plows it. The city doesn't either. And they maintain one of the things that I understand most HOAs originally got started for, which is a water retention pond. So I'm told that is kind of the origin of HOAs. So this adds some authority to an HOA that doesn't have it now or attempts to add authority, doesn't have it now, never sought it, never wanted it. Now suddenly they have a federal regulation that says you got to make this decision. ARRL says, they don't have to. But if they don't, then can the ham do whatever they want?
Ham can't do whatever he wants unless he's willing to violate a federal law because he lacks a prior approval.
Right.
Except that if they don't give an approval, then that is not, then they're violating the law by not acting.
Failure to grant an approval.
That's it.
Is not the equivalent of a prior approval. So the ham doesn't have what he needs under federal law.
So in the notes there, basically the ARRL's comment or position was like 90% of the new housing starts or whatever has some kind of CCNR, and that in the CCNRs there probably already is some kind of restriction, and in that roads only HOA it would already be in the CCNRs to say, hey, you can't have this antenna.
So that
roads only HOA wouldn't have the CCNRs that said that?
Correct. It has rules about roads.
Just about the roads.
Yeah. Yeah. This is one of those, again, I'm not sure, I don't have any statistics and I haven't seen anybody toss any out other than the ARRL saying 90%, and I don't know where they got that. I'm sure that there's a few HOAs out there that don't have any rules like that. Most of us have never encountered one. Fred, have you come? Well, you haven't been dealing with HOAs yet. You will be.
Oh, that's not true. I do.
Yes, you do.
I do routinely. But let me give an example. If you own a home around a lake in Maine, it's highly likely that it's a dirt road and there's a roads association that plows it. There may be a common beach. There may be a picnic area. This is extremely common in the state of Maine.
I'm going to make the folks in Maine mad at me by calling them an edge case as a whole state.
Okay, but so even in the edge case, so if their CCNR says you have to maintain the road and you can't leave your car parked on the road and whatever else, if there isn't anything specifically in there that says you can't erect an antenna, isn't that, you know, implied consent to put one up?
No, because the rule says prior approval.
Prior approval.
If there's a community association, you need prior approval. That's it.
Okay. So I guess I want to ask now what the remedy is for that. How do you just put in some language that says if there is no association, then no prior approval is necessary? Is that as simple as that?
You're going to take your show way too long if you begin to ask us how to rewrite this.
Okay.
However, Gary, I will tell you, I believe that there are ways to bring this up to acceptable or bring it up to good, not perfect.
Okay, so we'll talk about that right at the end when we decide how much longer we can stand this. Exclusive use. Very clearly says that you can only put your antenna on the property you own. No common areas. So no antennas on the roof of a condo, on a multi-story building if you don't own the whole building. No dipoles attached to a common area tree. It clearly favors single detached homes, and the ARRL agrees, and they say it's unreasonable to expect to be able to demand to put up an antenna on a common area. You can ask, and you can get permission, but you can't say I have to, and they don't expect rules that would require the association to let you do that.
Oops. That's a weather warning.
Oh, wow.
Weather alert.
And it's a loud one.
National Weather Service severe storm warning.
Oh, so you may get blown off the map as we talk here.
He can't hear you.
He can't hear me.
But not during the replay.
Yeah.
So that's okay. We don't edit anything out.
Yeah.
So are you safe where you are?
Well, I'm here, aren't I?
But okay. if it suddenly goes dark and then goes blank, we'll know what happened. So should HOAs have to grant hams antenna access in common areas? Is that a reasonable thing to ask?
I think they could set up very strict rules controlling the installation of an antenna. And in fact, if you'll think about this, let's assume a multi-dwelling unit, an MDU. And you live on the north side of the building. Are you entitled to put up a satellite receive only dish? Well, if you put one up on your side of the building, looking out your window on your lanai, on your porch, you have no view of the satellite. So then essentially you wind up talking about putting it up on the roof. That's a strategy available, as I understand it, but I'm not quite as positive about this, but I think that's a strategy available to dish subscribers or the, you know, satellite TV receive only direct broadcast service subscribers.
That's under the OTARD rules?
Under the OTARD rule.
Yeah. So now we want parity with that.
Yeah. Now, if we get parity with the OTARD rule or many elements of it, boy, I'm right on the road to happiness.
Yeah, we're in good shape. That's kind of what we've...
There's an interesting thing here, Gary, by the way. Let us assume for a moment that under the OTARD rule, over-the-air reception devices, you erect a broadband Yagi that covers from 56 megahertz at channel 2 way up into the 800s. And now you're getting nice digital television reception. That same antenna could cover 6 meters. If it's just a tad longer, instead of starting at 56 megahertz, it starts at 50 and get you through a whole lot of VHF and UHF bands. It's legal for television watching and illegal for ham radio.
Well, it would be difficult to come up with a ability to tell whether someone's receiving ham radio. Oops, I pushed this button instead. Receiving ham radio, but transmitting becomes another issue. And I think the OTARD rules, do they specifically address transmitting? I'm not sure, but I think no. they specifically address it
by
not including it.
Because part of the OTARD rule is that it includes broadband wireless internet.
Yeah, you got to have both ways because of WISP. The internet stuff.
Okay, so you can transmit.
You know what a WISP is? Wireless Internet Service Provider?
Yeah.
Okay, so
I do now.
That's transmitting.
Yeah. Yeah, you have to go both ways.
Okay.
I think that's 39 gigahertz, I thought, somewhere up there, but I'm not sure.
I don't know how deep the rules get into just what you can and can't do. So,
if the question was receive only versus receive and transmit, the WISP example proves that you can transmit under the OTARD rule.
Okay. Maybe they get a little more detailed about what you can transmit and power. I don't know whether any of that's there or not.
Same thing with a flagpole, Fred.
So bottom line here is maybe we could do a little bit about exclusive use. We don't expect to have as much control over that as we do our property, but maybe it could do a little more. We talked about this changes a simple rule violation into a federal law violation.
We talked about that.
Yeah, because it doesn't it doesn't grandfather your existing antenna. Right. So yeah, so we'll go ask under the same conditions that everybody else has who wants to put up a new antenna. No enforcement mechanism. OTARD rules have enforcement positions. They say that if you're unable to resolve it directly, you can file a petition for a declaratory ruling with the FCC or a court of competent jurisdiction.
But so, the burden is where?
On
of going forward.
On you, I guess.
Fred, I think it's on the...
My screen froze there. Would you please repeat
the question? The burden is on whom in an OTARD case to proceed...
The burden is denied. In an OTARD case, the burden is on the organization that or the party that seeks to enforce a rule. In other words, it's normally on the association to petition the FCC for an exception because they're the ones seeking to enforce the rule. And by the way, the FCC, I don't know of a case. Maybe there's one out there, but I don't know of one where the FCC has ruled in favor of the association.
That's right.
Does the OTARD rule require an advance permission, or you just...
No. In fact, it very specifically says that the TV watcher can go ahead first, and then the association petitions the FCC, in essence, to take it down.
All right.
And by the way, that's the OTARD rule. For the Communications Act, cellular telephone cases, they have the equivalent of a speedy trial. They have a fast track piece of language in the cellular telephone rules.
But the point is, it doesn't apply to us in one way or another.
That's quite true. But the question was, can you get these kinds of remedies and things written into law? And the answer is yes.
But we don't know if the negotiators on behalf of ARRL raised those issues.
Because we don't know what they did. They're not talking.
Right.
All right. So I've gotten to the end of the issues, and I'm at the what do we do next point, which is the options that I'm seeing are, it's already been passed by the House. It has not been passed by the Senate. Get the Senate to pass a revised bill, and then it goes to a conference committee between the House and the Senate.
Who's going to argue that bill, though? I mean, who's going to argue to make the change? The ARRL's not going to do it. Who would do it? Is that Fred? We all got to give Fred money and hire Fred to fix it? That might be a month or two worth of Arvin.
I think, as a practical matter, if you force it into conference committee, the conference committee is probably going to seek help to find out what's acceptable to the parties. And I have a lot of confidence in our democracy, and I think that the staffers on the Hill will probably do a very good job of trying to come up with something that works for the parties. Now that, you know, one side or the other, both will probably be disappointed with the outcome, but at least you have a shot in the conference committee. And the other part of it is, if you are petitioning your directors to have the ARRL withdraw support, then this so-called compromise language, which has been agreed to by the parties, is no longer agreed to by the parties. So you can ask your director to encourage the board to withdraw its support. You can ask your senator, especially if it's a senator who sits on science, technology, and commerce, I think, to oppose it, because that's where the action happens in committee.
But opposing it is kind of dangerous, because that just stalls things and it never goes anywhere. It has to be amended.
Oh, well, if they oppose it, then in order to get it through the House, it will be amended. Get it through the Senate, it will be amended, or else it'll be dropped and we start all over again.
Is there such
a bad alternative?
Well, let's get to that in a minute. Is there any chance in hell that this is actually going to get a House Senate conference committee? Because they're all expecting this to be one of those things where they vote on 100 bills in one session, and they go through their official language, bring it up, vote next. They don't want to talk about this.
I still have the question of, well, go ahead and answer Gary's question, but I think we're missing one.
As you've learned, basically any one senator can prevent a unanimous consent passage.
And they can do it anonymously if they want. Go ahead, David.
You know, it seems like if we get to the point where we want them to amend it, and as you pointed out, Fred, that hopefully they would go to someone who understands or knows what the amendment should be. My question is, they're just going to go back to the ARRL and the CAI, and look like the ARRL put up their FAQ, and the FAQ was pretty clear that they at least defend what they agreed upon. Is it really going to change the, can to and or to and? Or is there really going to be any other value to doing that? Or are they just going to say, hey, we agreed upon it all and this is what we should do?
I think it's perfectly possible for the ARRL to step in at any point in the game and say, we had support of the membership. We've lost that support. We need to revisit the drafting.
Okay.
Well, let me ask a question. Maybe even Fred has an answer. How would the average ham access the committee process individually? I don't think you can do that so readily. It has to be by somebody with some greater horsepower.
You're talking about the Senate committee?
Yes. Now, I know that an individual can see Senate staff. So it is possible to do if you're savvy, willing to come to Washington, make a meeting with a staff member and express the concern. So that's the answer to my own question. That can be done.
Go to your local office. Every senator has one or two or five
local offices,
in-state offices.
Right.
But you can also go to the staff on the Hill. And that is probably right.
Let's see. Who do we know that lives in Washington?
There's more than one way to approach the question. If that's the answer to Gary's point, there's more than one way.
Right. All right. So the other thing I've got here is hope or encourage the FCC to make rules that spell things out better than the minimum they get through this legislation. You're not a fan of that. I know you're not.
I haven't seen good examples where the rulemaking process resulted in really good advances for the radio hams, but that doesn't mean it couldn't happen. It's not outside the realm of possibility. And if we should be facing this bill passed into law. That's certainly what I would be recommending.
This would go through the usual rulemaking process: a notice of proposed rulemaking, comments, reply comments, and then finally a rule, right?
As best I know it.
Yeah.
Jim has a career full of experience with NPRMs.
Yeah, too much. The answer is yes, but you know, the FCC is very limited under the current language to do very much.
And that's what one of the things the ARRL is saying, that they don't have a lot of wiggle room.
That's correct.
And they're right on that.
Okay. So, my last question is 555 better than what we have now or worse than what we have now?
My answer is worse than what we have now.
And my answer is no. It's not better.
Okay. So even though there are, I won't put a number on it, but lots of hams that are going up against our homeowners associations with no ammunition, because the homeowners association has the ultimate authority. They can just say no. And they don't have to justify it. And if you tried to go to court, you would almost certainly lose because the rules say these are the rules.
Well, Gary, Barney Wall, N60I, has made the point that in the past, we had, as people representing radio hams, available to us the standard equitable arguments that include latches. Latches is when you go to court and you say, they can't go after me now, they've slept on their rights. Their opportunity to act has passed. That defense available today will become unavailable in the future because of the new requirement of a prior
rule.
So I don't understand it well enough. It sounds like, well, how would that come into effect, the latches, if they've got a rule in there on their books and maybe you put up an antenna and didn't ask and they didn't come enforce it?
I'll give you a quick example. Let's assume for a moment that the community association has a rule against basketball nets outdoors in the driveway. And there are 500 homes in the community association, 499 of which have basketball nets in the driveway. You seek to put up a basketball net in your driveway. The association comes after you. You go to court and say, latches apply. They are not allowed at this point in the game to enforce this rule against me. Under the facts that I've put before you, I have high hopes that the court would find in favor of the 500th basketball net.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And everything between 0 and 500
becomes more arguable.
It's a jump ball.
Yeah. Because, you know, that the analogy doesn't translate to ham radio very well, because in your 500 homes, you might have 3 or 4 hams. Maybe
it might be if you're number 10. Yeah. Is that the point?
Yeah, that's only one point. In it, there are other issues that have to do with the application of homeowner association rules, common covenants and restraints and regulations issued under them. For example, they have an association which has been moribund, has done nothing in 24 years, and the association is going to expire next year. And this officious neighbor comes after you. You may be the only antenna in the community, but they haven't enforced any other rules. You can also use the latches argument.
As a defense.
As a defense.
So what do you think we should do next? Somebody come up with alternative language, find a willing senator to get it included as an amendment, push into the conference committee process, drag the CAI along for the ride, or ignore the CAI, who is, by the way, watching the show. Hi, guys. I'm sure they are. Probably not now. They've probably fallen asleep by now, but
Gary, I think you have a future as a lobbyist.
I'm old.
That is, so, in so fact, are, yes, no, you've described the process.
That's the requirement. That's perfect.
The requirement.
You've done, you may it. Not be old enough.
How much money is there in it for me? Probably
more
a lot.
$30.
Yeah, a lot.
There are a lot of non-lawyers who go into the lobbying business after leaving government, and they don't work for poverty wages.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay, so we distracted from the issue here. What do we do next?
You described it. I would encourage ARRL directors and vice directors to withdraw support. I would work with others on the drafting of alternative language for the entire bill or for parts of the bill. And I would approach Senate staffers in the home district as well as on the Hill, especially staffers for the relevant committee. I would do exactly what you said.
So based on what Marty said, when we talked about earlier on about the vice directors and directors, you know, have to toe the party line, even if they go to the board and the board's already decided, the board doesn't really need to do anything. I guess if there's enough of them that go to the board to say, hey, we're really rethinking this all, the board might decide that it's the wrong thing.
The definition,
I just wonder if that's, yeah.
The definition of enough of them,
yeah,
is a majority.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. Any director can
plus one.
Any director can make a motion, get it voted on. So
and it will get it voted on by the directors, but the board, does the board not still have the ability to say, yeah, that's nice, we've invested a lot? Because I guess you look at it this way:
the directors
are the board.
The directors are
the board. Directors are the board.
The same people. But still, so look at this way, and this came up in the chat room. I think it was Jim Aspinwell. Well, what happens now if the ARRL comes back and says, hey, you know, hold on a second, we realize that this is not the right thing, and we'd like to withdraw the support. Seems like egg on their face. And might they do that, or might they?
I, given a choice, I'd prefer egg on the face of ARRL to the harm done to radio hams.
No, I totally agree with you 100%. Is the board going to feel that way?
Well, somebody has already, when they wrote up this fact, they said,
yeah, right.
We see your arguments and we disagree. So they're probably
right, I guess
not going
to. That was,
go
that was the point. That was the point why I brought this up.
So the next thing is John Q. Hamm, who's being recommended to call their senator by president of the league. What do we
to really call their director and their vice director? Say
instead,
you know,
yeah, don't call your senator yet, or what are we telling them to do?
All of the above.
Okay, rewind, playback.
Well, no. So I guess what you're saying, Fred, is we should even call our senator and our senators and say, hey, this isn't the right bill, and call our directors and vice directors saying, hey, this isn't the right bill. Does that mean, is that the message across the board?
Yes.
It's the right message if you agree that what we have today, which is nothing, is better than this bill. If you think that this bill is better than what we've got today, the chances of getting something new are, you know, something revised or something totally rewritten, agreed to, passed through all the positions in Congress that they have to go through, are a big fat unknown, giant question mark. I'm not going to say there's zero. They have no idea. That's the point. I don't know. I don't think you guys know what the odds of starting over or even drilling into the middle and tweaking things in terms
of success. I'll go out on a limb and say, if they didn't get it right the first time, what's the chance that they'll get it right if they have to go back to the table?
There's an answer to that.
Okay.
As best we know, there were only two guys from the league in the room with CAI. Maybe three. There was the lobbying firm, the Hudson Division Director,
Mike Lysenko,
and the General Counsel,
Chris Emily.
Maybe you have to change the guys in the room.
Got it. Okay.
And please do not hear me to be saying that they acted in their hearts against the interests of radio hams. we're only disagreeing about the bill and not the quality of those human beings.
Right. It was the product that came out wasn't the right product is what I think you're saying. Is that right, Fred?
That's right.
Yeah. As we went through this, the impression that I got was that the remedies that you're looking for, the tweaks, are not enormous. They are fine-tuning. They are not rewriting.
I agree with you, but we can't get those tweaks done at the conference level if there's no conference because the two bills are identical. We can't get those tweaks done at the FCC if the rule in the bill is so narrowly drawn as it is today, and there's not much room for wiggling. And we can't get those tweaks done if the board is unwilling to act.
So it sounds like your preference would be to have the Senate amend their bill, go to conference committee. If it can be shown that the CAI agrees with the amendments, are probably in pretty good shape, plus or minus the ability to get anything through Congress. It's been pretty remarkable that anything has gotten through so far at all.
I suggest to you that the reason this got through the House so readily is that CAI was taking the position on behalf of its members that this was a huge win for them.
This, exactly. That's what it sounds like, right? This is their win.
Well, it's way better than the original bill was for them.
Correct.
And when I look at it and see effective outdoor antenna language, and I'll admit I did not see that or when it came to minimum practicable regulation, but I'm still not sure I see how that's a total killer. I can see it's a problem. I'll have to go do the rewind and playback myself because I think I understood it better a little while ago than I do now.
Just read each of those clauses independently aloud, and it becomes a little bit clearer.
Yeah. So I think I kind of lean to the side of this is better than nothing, and I'm kind of worried about trying to change it at this relatively late date, although no one knows what the Senate would do with it. I don't know if Bill Nelson has changed his mind or not.
I can tell you that my position as an advocate for radio hams who live in community association controlled territory is that my guys would be better off with no bill than with this bill.
Yeah. And that's where I have a hard time because I'm trying to look again away from the edge cases and at most, but I think anyway, are most community associations. I got that right? Community associations?
Yep.
I'm trainable. Is that right now they have all the power and this, the language I've used before, and now I've got to rethink and see if this language that I feel, if I still feel comfortable with it, is that removes the power of no and gives you a seat at the table.
For minimal practical. I think that's what I'm getting from you guys, right? They can come and say, yes, you have a seat at the table, and the HOA can say, that's right, go ahead and put up your quarter wave, 70 centimeter, whatever, and that's accommodating you for everything that we need to accommodate. Is that where we're going? Is that the point?
Then I've got to make my argument to them and say, that is not, it's not reasonable. There's nothing reasonable about that. You don't understand what this is all about. You're just being led by the nose to say as much no as you can. and I will take you to court and fight you on it. And we'll try to, you know, cause we all do that bluster. We all do that macho. Yeah, we're going to court. you know, when push comes to shove and I see how much money it's going to cost to hire Fred and go to court, I may change my mind and put up a 2-meter antenna. But, the last question is, if this goes through as it is the argument over forever?
Well, I don't hold out any hope for a revisit in the House or the Senate of this matter in the next decade.
Not because again, it's still almost unbelievable that we've gotten to this point, right on the edge. And the ARRL is going to play that card pretty heavily.
So let me leave you with one example here, Gary. At breakfast at the Dayton Hamvention, not this past year, but the year before, I was approached by a guy who said to me, I live on 55 acres of northern Wisconsin. We have a road association. All they do is plow the roads. But I have to contribute. Under this, I'd have to get prior approval for the towers I have on my 55-acre lot. Now, and I ask you, is he better off or worse off?
Yeah, I think he's worse off.
But, right. Now let's step away from the 55 acres and go to everybody who has a house around a lake with a dirt road. Is he better off or worse off? I suggest he's worse off. Mm-hmm. So what I'm getting at is there's no laddering in this statute. There's no difference between the guy who lives in a multi-dwelling unit building that looks like an apartment building, the guy who lives in a townhouse and has his own backyard, the guy who lives on a single-family lot and has an acre or two, and the guy who has 55 acres, and all that happens is a road association is now being given power. The road association is being given power, and the ham's being given a requirement for prior approval. I have very different sentimental attachments to the guy in the apartment building and the guy on 55 acres of northern Wisconsin. I think they're in very different places, and we have a one-size-fits-all statute.
I can see that. And I'm, because from my perspective, you know, I'm sitting here just outside of Raleigh, North Carolina, surrounded by a few hundred thousand single-family houses, every one of which has an HOA with a regulation that either says you have to get permission or you can't put up anything, and some even say you can't even use a transmitter inside your house, to which, of course, we all want to say, hold up a cell phone and say, excuse me, but it's there. And, you know, those are the folks I've been thinking about, so I guess I need to broaden my thinking a little bit, too.
Yeah, well, the apartment building environment is a little bit different because there's no private property.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, does this give someone in an apartment building OTARD-like? No, because they don't own anything. They get nothing.
No, it leaves them out.
They're out of this entirely.
They get a 70-centimeter whip sticking out the window.
Okay. All right. I think we've gone about as far as we can or need to go. Let me stick up some titles here. We got Fred. Let me make you full screen and give you there we go. You're sitting behind your book, but that'll work. Thank you very much for coming on the show and helping us understand this issue. Those guys at my radio club that felt uncomfortable bringing it up at the club, maybe now they've got something to talk about. So anything, any last word from you?
I think you've done a great job of summarizing it, Gary.
All right. Appreciate that. Because, you know, first of all, I'm trying to figure out what buttons to push here. You know, just a little TV ham and you're a lawyer. So that's, you know, we're not on even footing here. So if you think I did a good enough job, I will take that. Let's head up to, push all the right buttons. And Jim, let's see if I can find your title. There it is. You went into private practice after the FCC for a while. Are you retired now or are you still working?
I'm working as little as possible.
Once in a while, someone calls.
That's right.
All right. And we'll do that show someday. But you'll spill all the beans and tell all the dirt. How circumscribed are you from talking about what happened back when you were working?
I'm circumscribed by memory lapse.
that's like me.
He can tell you how many years he worked at the FCC.
Yeah. I mean, did they make you sign an ARRL loyalty oath?
No, but when they offered me an early out, I can tell you that I clocked it. It was 2 nanoseconds.
Okay, so
for me to sign the paper.
Not a job that you really, really, really enjoyed.
Well, I did at times. It was a great, it was actually a very good career in many ways. Yeah.
Okay. And let's see. trying to, oh, that's, I got that button pushed. I'm still trying to learn how my system works. Thank you guys. I'm going to talk to David for a minute. Yep. I'm going to hang up with you guys and,
yeah, thank you so much.
And thank you.
And I'm guessing we'll be back with you guys at some point in the future, if you're willing to come along. Okay. Sure. I'm going to push the goodbye button there on Jim. Thanks very much.
I look forward to your show on the loyalty oath.
Yeah, that'll be interesting. Yeah,
me too, actually.
Okay. Goodbye, Jim.
7-3, guys.
Jim is out of here. Goodbye, Fred. Fred is out of here. And that's just you and me. That was cool.
Good. I'm glad. I think this was what I was hoping for.
Did you see anything in the chat room that didn't, you know, didn't come up?
I tried to insert all the questions. And sorry, guys, in the chat room, if it sounded like I was trying to make them my own. as we went through, I tried to pull all the things that I thought were appropriate, and put them in there. So thank you, chat room, and it was good. This was a more lively chat room than usual, and you know, I think we hit about 14 at one point. We're about 9 right now. Folks sticking around
because so, I told them they'd get the best stuff at the end.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. So we'd about doubled our average audience.
Yeah.
And we'll see where this goes.
I think this is one of the topics that, you know, a lot of hams are interested in. This doesn't affect me in one way, shape, or form because I'm not today in an HOA. And I think based on, you know, my experiences, stuff like the fact that the nosy neighbor puts his head over the fence and sees that I have an antenna that you can't see from the street, and they make me take it down because I didn't follow the whatever, just boils my, you know, and makes me think I'll never, if I can at all help it, ever go live in an HOA somewhere.
And maybe you won't. I take it it's an older neighborhood.
Yeah.
And there are some of those around here. Jeff, AC4ZO, the ubiquitous Jeff, the poly, I'm trying to come up with a word I don't really know very well. His neighborhood doesn't have an HOA. It was built in the 50s or 60s.
Yeah.
So he can do whatever he wants, and he's got dreams of a tower. But then his ham radio career is almost over. So
yeah, in Los Angeles, for the most part, most of the communities don't. You know, this house I think is built in 68 or something like that. And there are new developments in the city, and they do have them. And, you know, most of the townhomes and condos and whatever, they'll have them because of, again, you know, common areas. But just doesn't affect us at all.
Yeah. Where I grew up in the 60s in a house that was probably built in the 40s or, you know, early 50s, no HOAs. Us kids, mm-hmm. we scrambled all over the roof. We put up anything, put up antennas, mm-hmm. took them down. Anything we wanted to do, didn't think about what the neighbor saw. Nothing was too outrageous. My friend, my mentor, did put up a big tri-band beam and got nasty looks from neighbors. But again, there was nothing they could do. The first place that I owned was a townhouse. And after we moved in, after we bought it and moved in and looked, we discovered that there was a homeowners association that had rules about antennas. And we checked mm-hmm. to see who they were, and they were defunct. They were defunct from the moment the builder let things go. He never really established one. So, but I guess that's one of those situations where should a neighbor have decided they didn't like my 2-meter beam up on the roof, they could have done something about it if they even knew.
Right.
I think we're always going for the worst case scenarios. Everybody, as far as human nature, to dig out what we are really afraid of and think that's probably what's going to happen. And sometimes it will, but most of the time or much of the time it won't. I still think that Fred and Jim were bringing up cases, not, you know, maybe at the hinterlands, but still not the big goose egg part or the big bubble in the middle of the bell curve of where most of us live. I think that they were looking a little toward the fringes, but they will say they weren't. So,
well, I think Fred's point was there's the guy in the 55 acres and there's the guy in the townhome. And I'm starting to see where, you know, a guy in like your situation if you were in an HOA and, you know, tract home kind of situation, it would apply to you too. And yeah, I don't know.
I do agree. I don't think that we would get a revisit if this goes in. That's what we live with for a long time. So maybe stopping now, even though it seems fourth quarter, 11th hour, is still the better plan. I'd like to see what someone would come up with as an alternative, and that we're going to endlessly debate that.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's the way things go.
So I guess the question is, where's that grassroots movement start to ask them to stop?
Yeah.
Is that here right now? Call your senator, call your director and your vice director and say, maybe this isn't the right one.
Yeah. And from a very practical standpoint, that's not going to happen.
Yeah.
A few people, watching this show or reading the stuff that CQ and that Fred is put online, will do something like that. I think the league is still the 800-pound gorilla, and they don't have a lot of success. They have some success, but they don't have as much as they want in getting people to make those calls and take that effort. And when you put something like this in front of people, I suspect that the real result will be to create a certain amount of inertia, and they'll... maybe they were going to call their senator and now they're just not going to do anything.
Right. Well, they've already created that inertia. It's not going to slow down.
Well, yeah. Cool. So we'll see. I'd like to see what the alternative is, even though somebody will publish it on QRZ.com and it'll get 1,000 responses. All trolls.
Yeah, that's probably true.
Yep. So talking about a couple other things, as long as we're here and don't have any audience left, was hoping to do another Eclipse show and had crickets out there, crickets from everybody we've contacted. So
yeah,
I don't see doing that. Okay. There's an interesting show to do just looking through the responses to the previous Eclipse shows that we've done on QRZ.com and on Reddit. There is a huge... noisy. Well, let me put it this way. There's a noisy, I don't know about huge. There is a noisy contingent of hams who do not like MCOM.
Yeah.
Everything anyone does in MCOM is whacker. All they want to do is put lights on top of their car and go through red lights. And I don't know what their problem is. We know that there are hams out there that are like that. They want to put decals on their car and they want to put on lights and they want to put on a uniform and feel official. And there are some like that.
Mm-hmm.
But these guys are saying that's everyone. And I don't think it's that many.
I don't think it's that many.
Within your groups, you got uniform wearing, decal stuck, light blinking hams. Oh, you're one of them. I guess we've seen some pictures. You guys do have some uniforms.
Yeah, we do try to look uniform in that. It's a tool, right? And so it helps for folks to understand who we are and what we do. And, if everybody shows up in a Hawaiian shirt or a Coors t-shirt or whatever, you have no idea what we're doing other than we've got all these radios around.
I mean, we tell people not to show up in that. Tell people not to show up in a t-shirt that says hams do it with more frequency.
Yes, absolutely. So the uniform's a tool, and the decals on the car help you stand out, and the lights, we work a lot on the side of a road, and actually, in certain municipalities, including where I am, if you are along the side of the road and you are working, it's a requirement. You have to have that amber safety light so that folks don't just ram into you. Not everybody has them. Not everybody agrees that they're the right thing. In fact, some of the organizations that we work with ask you not to have them. And, my question always is, okay, well, you can ask me not to use them, but I need to have them for the other groups, or what am I supposed to do when I am working on the side of the road to make it legal?
Yeah. Okay. Well, and anyway, so it looks like no more Eclipse shows. I'm running out of time.
I think there'll be an Eclipse show afterwards. I think we'll have a recap one.
Could do
one. And maybe it'll be me, depending on when you come back, or maybe it'll be after. And I think mostly it'll be if something does happen. There'll be the little news story here and there that this thing happened and amateur radio helped or didn't help and could have. I sent you a little news article about, was it Bigfoot?
Yes.
Did you see that?
Yeah, I think that was right here in North Carolina.
Yeah, yeah. That's why I said hopefully Cindy will be safe.
Yeah. Well, they were recommending you not shoot Bigfoot.
Yes, don't shoot Bigfoot, especially during the eclipse.
Because Bigfoot is likely to be some hot, sweaty guy in a gorilla suit.
Right.
Hawking used cars or something, so.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. It'll bring out the wackos.
So I'll start working around looking for those wacky M-cone guys that wear uniforms and have lights on their cars to see if we can work a show up.
Okay.
And I've been listening around for the Emron stuff for this weekend. Not a whole lot, but I'll keep working on that show too.
Oh yeah, I forgot all about that. That's no one knows what we're talking about because it's all been offline discussion. Yeah. Emron is it's a prepper version of how do we spell that? A-R...
Yeah. A-M-R-O-N.
A-M-R-R-O-N.
Yeah.
2 R's. Yeah. It's a group that takes a fairly rigorous approach to the idea of watching out for end times, for when the poop hits the prop. But as I went through their website, a fair amount of reasonable looking stuff about their connection to ham radio.
Yep.
And you were discovering that they're kind of hard to get a hold of.
They want to be kind of private. I mean, their tagline is a nationwide emergency communications network for preppers and patriots.
Yeah.
And they want to,
There's even if we never get one of those guys, parsing their website will be fun.
Yeah. Through that.
Yeah.
I'll keep working on it.
All right. For those of you that are watching on Facebook, we're going to wrap this up for the YouTube version and say goodbye and stuff, but I'm going to see if Marty's available. Let me go dig out my browser.
He was in the room earlier. It doesn't look like he's there. All right.
Yeah. I've lost control of everything here. I'm just going to go right back to, right back to Wirecast. As we always say, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by, that's not the right button. There we go.
I was ready for the point. It's brought to you by you. Yeah. I'm a little closer to my camera.
We should both do this.
By you.
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, well, I've discovered one of the things with these live titles is that I end up not having such a good picture to make the poster for YouTube and the other places.
Yeah.
Because I used to put the titles in post and I could always take them out. Now they're stuck. They're in here.
All right.
There's your Arvin.
There's my Arvin. This
is harder to do than it looks.
It is. There's your Arvin over there.
HamRadioNow.tv is the place to go if you enjoy the programs. We are also a proud member of the Begging for Funding Foundation.
So. Woo! That was stupid ham tricks. We will never do that again. I'm only pointing at my Arvin from now on.
All right. So you are.
I am David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
Prepper extraordinaire, apparently.
No.
Well, get there. Lights, siren. You got a siren?
No.
PA system?
No, siren. No.
Amber lights.
Actually, so amber lights in the back. There is a PA system in my Go box hooked up to the CB radio, but mostly, it's used. We use it at events if we got to find somebody or what have you, but not in the truck.
You got amber lights. Do you have the little flashing lights attached to your brake lights
There's an amber bar in the back window, and actually the window is tinted off and it's factory tint that you can't even see it's there until the amber lights are on, but they're nice and bright. Okay. And I've been trying to figure out what in the front, because for some of the things we do when we're on the road, we need to have that as well. Haven't gotten there yet.
And a uniform. Gordon West wears a uniform for his Aerie stuff. So
there you go. I wear one for Boy Scouts too. There's nothing wrong with uniforms.
That Gordon West may not be the argument that tips the balance one way or the other. I don't know. Excuse me.
Gordon's got the flashy lights on his car too.
Yeah, I'm sure he does. All right. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, the guy that pushes all the buttons and occasionally I'm getting better. I'm not good at it yet, but I think I'm getting better. Make them all go away so that we've got room for the little banner to come by. As we say, over.
And out.
I have another problem when I'm doing titles and stuff is that I make fun, happy faces now and then. And once in a while you smile, but every time I make a fun,
I have to work on it.
Every time I make a really good, fun, happy face that I can use for a title, you're going,
sorry. Okay. We can practice here. Let me get my glasses straight.
I'm looking at the camera, not at you. So I don't know what you're doing.
I'm smiling. But you know, the other thing is you've got to capture high res. Cause I've tried to do a couple of captures from the shows and they're not high enough res when I capture them for whatever reason. I tried to send them a picture cause I'm doing a talk at Pasadena Amateur Radio Club on the 22nd. And they said the picture was too pixelated when they blew it up.
Hmm.
And I'm not really sure what that's all about.
Pulling it off of YouTube.
I don't remember what the heck I did. Yeah, I think I pulled it off of YouTube.
Because you don't want to get it from Facebook. Facebook destroys it.
Yeah, I think I did it. I think I did. Maybe I'll try it again. I think yeah. I did like a...
And you want to make sure that you're on a 1080 monitor and...
Full screen and all that.
And that YouTube is giving you a 1080 signal, which they will, but sometimes you have to ask for it.
Yeah. Marty says he's not happening right now.
Okay, so no Marty. Sorry, guys.
We got to do it soon though, because he needs some more fanfare.
Well, yeah, we can say that Marty has won the young amateur ARRL. They give their own. This is the Newsline.
Yep, amateur radio Newsline.
Amateur radio Newsline. Bill Pasternak, WA6ITF, and I think Yesu's in on the deal. I think CQ's in on the deal. Young Ham of the Year, Yota. So that's why I call him Young Padawan.
Mm-hmm.
Won the Young Ham of the Year. You did.
Yes, he did.
The Yoda Award. The Yodel Award.
Yeah,
he has to get up in front of. He will receive that award at Huntsville.
Right.
He's asking me if I was going to go. Huntsville's the same weekend as the eclipse.
So you ain't going.
I ain't going.
I'm not going. But it has nothing to do with Marty.
Huntsville's like a good ham fest.
You got stuff.
Yeah.
This is a nice one.
It's all indoors, which, you know, is kind of nice because it's in August in Alabama. Mm-hmm. And although there's mountains nearby, it's not way up high in the cool, crisp mountain air.
Right.
So it's all indoors. It's a beautiful venue. The hams completely trash the place with their flea market. The giant room they're in is divided about three quarters flea market and about a quarter of vendors. And the vendors get red curtains and they make things look fairly nice in their little area, but the rest of it's all ham trash on tables.
So we're finally getting to ours in September, mid September. They're going to have one here in Torrance. And I think there was talk about having a flea market. They haven't had that for the last couple of years. But I think I have a Boy Scout thing that weekend. I'm going to try to do both because they're close to each other. I may sneak out for a little while and go.
It's always been the conventional wisdom that California doesn't have lots of big ham fests.
They don't. Visalia is a big one.
That's not a ham fest, though. That's a DX convention.
Yeah, right? I guess that's true. That's true.
Well, I mean, that's what they have. They have conventions.
Right.
I had another mentor in Chicago who wanted, we were starting up a ham fest, the radio club I was in, and he kind of wanted it to be a West Coast like hotel convention with nice ballrooms. And I don't think he wanted people to wear ties, but close. And, there are more hams in California than any place else. You kind of expect, and they had big flea markets, you know, the computer club flea markets and stuff, but I, you know, don't know. I've never tried much ham radio stuff out there. So, but I'll take your word for it. And the conventional wisdom that California is not big on ham fests.
Yeah. Not a ton of them. There's some here and there. All right, well, let's wrap up. I got to give away some Eagle Scout patches this afternoon.
Okay, so we did the over and out. So all I have to do now, since Marty's not going to be here, he's not here, right? For sure.
Yeah. Marty said, I hit him up on the chat and he said he just couldn't make it.
It's a contest weekend. He's doing contests.
Didn't say why. Maybe that was the case.
Yeah. We didn't see in the background with Fred, but behind him off to the side is his contest station. And there was a guy operating there. It's a CW contest. So we weren't hearing someone go, CQ, CQ. It was all Morse code. In fact, I've got...
Big noise floor there. There you go.
That IMI has been on there for a while. W1 IMI. See, I know Morse code.
Cool.
And no one's answering him. K1 IMI. And there's an answer.
All right, well, I'm still available in the early mornings or the afternoon if they finally come back to you tomorrow, but otherwise we'll just stand down and...
Yeah, I guess that's the other thing I was going to say. In addition to all the hams that gave us shade about MCOM, we also found out there are a lot of organizations that are doing something. There's one in Pocatello.
Absolutely.
A bunch are. They're just...
They don't want to come on and talk about
damn
it.
Damn MCOM people, you want to hide your light under a bushel.
Well, yeah.
You don't want to talk to us.
Yeah. And that's why I'm thinking after the event, there will be some stories to tell. Because there are people getting up and doing stuff.
Yeah.
And it may just be they come on and say, hey, nothing happened. It was great.
Well,
and we saw dark.
We want to know how you did nothing.
Exactly.
How you prepared to do nothing, even if it's just nothing.
And that'll be the after story.
Yeah. And we're really not all that successful in pulling those out either. In fact, what's wrong with you? Why are you here?
Yeah.
Why did you respond?
Yep. I don't know.
Okay.
I'll keep working on that.
I'm going to push the Facebook off
Stop
button.
The Facebook group. Bye, Facebook.
Bye, Facebook.
Thanks for following. There's still six in the room, so they love us till the very end.
See,
it's Glenn and maybe Betsy and a couple other folks.
You guys are awesome.
7-3 all.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Have a great rest of your weekend, Gary.
Facebook is off. And okay. So you guys, we did the ARVN over and out thing a long time ago. You've had your extra. It is time to push the off button on the recording as well.